Rasmus Astrup is a partner and design principal of SLA, and Frederic Chartier is working also together about reinventing Paris. So welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
And reinvent Paris now.
Yeah, thank you. Well, we are going to talk about nature because, you know, light is important, but what we achieved together here, Frederic and I and our companies, was to combine buildings with nature and, of course, daylight. So I just want to say thank you for the invitation to be here today. It's a great honor.
Yeah. First, I just want to introduce very, very quickly our office, Chartier Dalix, based in Paris. One side of our work is what was Rasmus saying, superposition, nature, architecture. One of the things is that all of our cities were really conceived separately between nature and architecture, and then we really tried in our project to combine the two and to see the result in terms of environment, social, and architectural things. Should I press on that? Yes. So just a little things that this is a book that is out right now, Hosting Life in Park Books. Just a little bit of a work about these subjects. This is a school we are doing in Boulogne. And all this work now, really merging the work from architects and from landscape designer. Voilà. These are also studies we are making, studying how biodiversity can really come into the buildings and make something different, all of our research. So that's really to show the work of our project, how vegetation can play also with sunshades, can really be something, not just only decoration, but really come into the architecture and make something different.
And I think that's one of the key points that we learned, that it's important to go out and have some daylight, because the artificial light we all know is really not healthy. Light needs to be dynamic, it needs to change. That's why daylight is so important for us as human beings. And nature is the starting point in what we do. Like you saw, Frederic's courtyard is actually full of concrete mixed with nature. We collect sand in our office and seahorses and mosses and all kinds of things, because you cannot Google them. You need to touch them to actually feel what nature is. So this is our office. We call it nature-based design. So we have a knowledge in our office that we bring in to the design and the way we work. Why do we do that? That's because we think that it's the best driver, it's the most important thing to work with. But luckily, there's also other issues. You know, we now learned that daylight is important. Nature is also important for human beings. That's, well, from my belief, where we came from. This is a little exercise made, how sick you can actually be if you are not in contact with nature. So in a lot of situations, we need to bring back nature into the cities. And this is an example. This is a nurse in a hospital that we designed. So she's crossing a parking lot. You know, normally a parking lot is full of asphalt. Asphalt is two words. It's the back of your body, and then it's fault. You know what it does? Because light, it heats up the temperature. It pollutes the water that lands on it. It's not pleasant to be on a land field of asphalt. So she's crossing the lot. She's going in to do a surgery, and she senses nature. She senses daylight. She relaxes. She can hear a bird. And then she's a better nurse when she joins the surgery. And I think you can also do that for school kids, like Frederic just showed. You can do it for employees. You can do it for a lot of situations, bringing nature into cities. This is a headquarter that we did, so the bank can actually enjoy the outdoors, the skaters, but also the people that work there. But then moving into Reinvent Paris, the project we were so lucky to win to together, I think this was maybe the highest honor that you and I received, was that when we made it to the front cover of National Geographic. And I think that shows where architecture is going today, that we need to actually change things in cities. It's not just about how it looks, it's what it does. But I will actually lead you to introduce it, my friend.
All right. Okay, so just the beginning. What is really interesting about this project is that first, this is crossing the Périphérique. Périphérique is a ring road of Paris. So we had the project to cover it, so to reduce in a way all the pollution, the air pollution, the sound, and everything like this. So we just, instead of doing a building, a slab, and then putting a building on this, this is really something like, so you see the site right now, this is really almost like a highway, the Périphérique road around Paris. The thing was really to build a structure, a bridge landscape, a paysage pont, we call this, so how this depth of the structure can become something more than just a structure. How we can program it, how we can put earth, nature, and everything inside this bridge so that it becomes just more than just a structure. And on the top of it, we just designed a couple of wood buildings that can be changed wherever after. So this is really the basic project, how you can cross the Périphérique with a building that holds nature, program, and is almost natural carbon conception.
So obviously, when we got to work with that, it was a big challenge, because what was then important was it how it looks or what it does, as I said before. So we started to investigate together that it's a big challenge to be asked to reinvent a city. And this was the starting point, that instead of starting sketching, we had to find out how were the realities. What is the situation? Because there's a lot of people who tried to reinvent Paris before, and there's a lot of people who will try to reinvent it in the future. And the reality is that Paris is the most polluted city in Europe. That's the reality. So something needs to be done. So instead of starting focusing on only a building, daylight, we need to see how can we contribute solving this situation. There's a lot of other items you have to focus on, traffic and so on, but Paris is actually a city where I, as a Dane, can learn a lot, because there's a lot of initiatives. So the reality is also that there's 400,000 that dies of air pollution in Europe yearly. New reports say that it's maybe 800,000. So this is something that we need to figure out to solve. Paris also have some records. They are the highest population, but they have the lowest green space. So all these factors came into the project. So we said, let's start to look at cities differently. Let's move from all the challenges into a solution. Again, it's not only just how does it look, it's much more how can we contribute to the city in a good way. So we started to look at the buildings three-dimensional. We started to look at how they interact with each other and the landscape. And then we came up to the client and we showed him this. And this is BNP, Banque Nationale Paris. And they were expecting something amazing. But this is actually what we agreed with. This is, we don't care how it looks. We wanted to clean the air. We wanted to harvest all the rainwater and reduce the noise. So if you start with that with a client, then you start with the values. You cannot go afterwards and say, I want to bring daylight. No, and then show it in a design. Look how much they... No, first you agree with the client that daylight is important. Then it's much easier afterwards. So the whole conversation, I mean, the stupidest thing architects does is actually to talk to everyone like they are also architects. Your clients is not architects. Some of them are, but talk to them like regular people. You have to convince politicians, citizens, your mom and dad and your kids and all that. So the conversation here became about how can we clean the air of this polluted site? It's still a courtyard. It's a regular courtyard, but it does something else to the human beings. It's also a bridge, like Frederic said. It's connecting the suburbs and the arrondissements, which is also socially very important in the city. So are you supposed to say something now?
Because we can,
I can talk
say
so
something.
Much.
No, just a word about what we thought in this, because when you know, you show that Paris is very polluted, because one big point is really this Périphérique. So there is a lot of research right now is that transforming this Périphérique, keeping this infrastructure, not erasing this, because we need this infrastructure, but really thinking this as the future of the green belt. So this is because there is a lot of lands crossing this Périphérique that we can really use, covering or not, and creating something different, like green infrastructure, something that really can be used for transportation, but also for keeping Paris less polluted. So this, the red dot is really the place where we are doing the building.
So it's changing a barrier into a connection. Exactly. And that's really, that was the grand gesture. And another connection is also the social connection. So what we did here was to say, we have all this technical knowledge on the one side that we design with, but there's also a social impact. We design for people. We also design for animals and plants. But it's important that both items are fulfilled in the design. So there's a lot of technical knowledge. We know a lot about rainwater. We know about the ecosystem. We know about how to clean the air with these elements. And that was kind of the concept that we went with. We even investigated mushrooms, because there's places in China where there is an investigation of mushrooms along the highways, and they actually eat the pollution and break it down. So the idea in the competition was that we covered the whole tunnel with mushrooms. So when you were driving underneath the project, you were driving under champignons, but it was too crazy for the client, so we had to... That was too much, but they can actually, again, it's nature that solves the problems. And this is the reality today, that we control the air. The pollution arrives with the air. So when we design with Frederic, we need to control where are the buildings, so we can control the air flow. So now there's a filter. That filter, like the propel back in your computer, drags in the air. Then the small mushrooms on the roots of the plants breaks down and eats the pollution, releases CO2, that is an intake from the plants, and water that they drink. So it's actually an ecosystem where we solve solution. We have solutions from nature to solve the challenges. So it's very delicate, it's very challenging, and Paris is a city that has these demands, which I really appreciate.
Yeah, we really like to think architecture has a system right now, not only has a building, but really has a system. And working with Rasmus was really a good experience for because after you design something with nature going really locally and domestic. For example, this is the study of the facade in different seasons. This is really interesting because you never think about this when you are designing a building. This is on winter, on autumn, and everything like this. And designing also, for example, micro landscapes that are cleaning the water with rain chain, so you have the rainwater coming down from one balcony to the other. And so when you design this, this is really becoming something, not adding vegetation on the building, but thinking the building has with the vegetation. So where you are inside, the view is very important, because you can imagine the railroad, the Périphérique, and then this micro landscape that is really dedicated to the people. And we had also to convince the client that, because when you put plants on a building, the first reaction from a client is, hey, how does it going to last? Because maybe the guy who doesn't like plants, he is going to let it die, and then your building is going to change. So we had this thought about, when I speak like a system is very important, going from one balcony to the other, if you see this plan, so you explain the people that are going to be on this building that they have to let access from the balcony so that once, two, three times a year, people can come and then take care of all the plants. So this is very important, so that at the end, this image, it's not only architecture with plants, it's really a mixed system of the two.
And I think it's also an expression of, again, having the conversation that we convinced both each other, but also the client about the purpose. We need to clean the air. So suddenly the discussion about having green as a decoration, which is often seen, there's a lot of green roofs that place no purpose to the building at all. So this was a way to maintain the idea from start to end, and also to bring it as people want to live there. And of course, we were challenged with the business case. We had the tea plantation, which was the only the plant that hasn't an intake of the heavy metal in the air pollution. So there's a tea plantation on top of the roof. You can buy tea. We found a company who can do the maintenance. So I think the whole holistic thinking in the project was really important. We even remember we had discussions, how can we have people maintenance it themselves so they become active of the green facade? I really love that.
Maybe we can show this last image. This was also the movie we made for the competition. Now we're just ending the studio, so it should start, the construction should start, I hope, next year. And so just an overview about what is also interesting is that you have housing on the left and then offices on the right. How do you connect the two? How do you make a system? So now you see the depth of the bridge. When you can put earth and programs in it, when you can enter really the garden in the middle, and how you can link the two roofs, making urban architecture, agriculture with the architecture, and making really a system out of wood with of the two buildings. Maybe you have to say something about the courtyard, no? Rasmus.
Yeah, I mean, I think the system is, again, this is showing the idea of having an ecosystem. So I think the courtyard is part of the ecosystem. It's the trees, it's the daylight, it's the view, like we learned today, from the buildings into the courtyard, but it's definitely also a social meeting point. And I think this project represents a strong collaboration between what we call the built and the grown environment, and still bringing some knowledge and solutions to cities. And one of the things we have discussed in the team is, imagine if our project can become a driver and an example of how to close Le Périphérique, change it into this connection instead of a barrier. And imagine if you can go to other cities and start to change infrastructure into something positive, because right now they are creating barriers between people and animals. You know, animals and insects also get killed by the cars. So you need to take it serious when you talk about green infrastructure. And I think our example shows a good direction for that.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.